copies. Backups for years.
So, I really went through the whole talk with this as background, because I really love this background, but it was too much work. It was a hard work getting this to line up, like really perfectly for the one slide. So who here has used COBOL before? I know I asked a few people. A lot of people. Who has, like, no idea about COBOL and is, like, wondering, So, in case you don't know me, I'm Walt Mankowski. I work as a postdoctoral researcher at Drexel doing, like, crazy image analysis stuff of microscope data. But before I became this, like, ivory tower academic, I worked at QVC for 10 years doing mostly COBOL. So most of the lessons that are in here are kind of gleaned from that. And so I always like to start with a cartoon. So let me read this. Can you read that in the back? Because this is user-friendly, which is a great old comic from back in the day. So, and, you know, I think a lot of people feel this way about COBOL. I kind of like COBOL too. So let's kind of like before, let's spend a few minutes just kind of giving a little introduction. So what's COBOL? So COBOL is it's a programming language. It stands for Common Business Oriented Language. It was created in 1959. So before even I was born. And like I think a lot of people consider it a dead language. When I went in 1990 to go work at QVC, I thought it was a dead language. I still, like, I haven't used it in 15 years, I kind of think it's a dead language now, but, like, it's really not a dead language, right? And it keeps rising from the dead over and over again, right? So, I want to found these on the interwebs as I was preparing this, and it's kind of amazing, right? Like, not only is it not dead, it's, like, it's really at, like, the underpinnings of the entire world financial system. Like, it's all working on COBOL still to this day. Like 90% of Fortune 500 companies, you know, like a huge percentage of business transactions, ATM transactions, point of sale things, like shipping containers, and there's like 5 billion lines of new COBOL being written every day. It's kind of crazy. So, well, like it's kind of a horrible language, but it's like this incredibly successful language here. So let's we kind of think that it's like so entrenched that you just can't get rid of it. That's partly it, but hopefully I will have convinced you by the end of the talk that there's some things that it does really well, and that's also part of the reason why it is still stuck around. So we all know who this is, right? Does anyone not know who this is? The young guy in the back, do you know who this is?
I've been too much inundated by her name.
Okay, so this is Grace Hopper. She retired as like a rear admiral or something in the Navy.
She's got awarded a presidential or a presidential.
Yes, posthumously, like just a few days ago.
Quick on the Wikipedia.
So she's widely credited as the creator of COBOL, and she played a part of it, but a number of other people played a part in it as well. I found this great quote by her. It says, humans are allergic to change. They love to say, we've always done it this way. I try to fight that. That's why I have a clock on my wall that runs counterclockwise. Just kind of, on the one hand, like a crazy thing for someone who's been associated with this language that we haven't been able to get rid of for like almost 60 years now. This is like exactly the kinds of things that people would say we're trying to, like, why COBOL is still around, like, we've still done it this way. But at the time that COBOL was created, it was a pretty radical departure from what had come before it. So, like I said, Grace Hopper as part of the DoD played a role in it. IBM also played a role in it. And it's very much like not designed by ivory tower computer science people like me. Languages, popular languages at the time, like Fortran is like the one that's still around, were written more like mathematics. They were mathematical formulas, and they were used to solve, you know, to do physics and to do, you know, missile trajectories and, you know, things of that nature, so like mathematical scientific things. So they had two main goals in doing COBOL. One was that they wanted to have an English language syntax. They didn't want the syntax to look like mathematical equations. They wanted it to look like sentences in like English language. And also they wanted the focus of it to be not to solve mathematical equations, but to do business computing, business like reports and personnel and money, all these things that, like, well, so the military, obviously they have to deal with, you know, machines in the building and rockets and things like that, but they also have personnel records and they had, you know, there's millions of people and they have to pay and they have to worry about where they're being assigned to and things like that. So that was the DoD's interest in the language. And IBM's interest in the language was that they were hoping that they could use this development work that was being funded by the DoD and then go and sell it to the corporations of the world, which is in fact exactly what they did. So, this is a Ferrari, Formula One car. I believe it's being driven by Fernando Alonso. It says his name somewhere. Right, in very carefully. So why do I have a picture of a Ferrari other than, like, okay, one is that I thought it would be funny to have a picture of a Ferrari and to talk about COBOL. But also, like, we think about, we all know that, like, Formula One cars have to go really, really fast. They can go well in excess of 200 miles an hour, but they also have to be able to go to corner really well. Right, this is a famous turn at Monaco, where they're doing this hairpin turn. So they can go 200 miles an hour. They do this hairpin turn at about 50 miles an hour, which is kind of crazy. And so people working on Formula One cars know that whatever you do is a trade-off between having the cars run really, really fast and be able to slow down really fast and corner as well. And we understand that there's engineering trade-offs in designing automobiles or anything mechanical like that, but I think that people don't understand that those same sorts of engineering trade-offs happen in computer languages as well. So, with that as kind of an introduction, let's see what COBOL really looks like. So, COBOL syntax. So, I found this, I don't know where I found this, that COBOL programs kind of its hierarchy, a lot like a corporate hierarchy, where at the top level is programs, and programs have divisions and sections and so on. I think modern languages look a little bit like this too. One weird thing is that many languages today have this kind of recursive syntax, and COBOL is really not like that. There's not like a BNF format for COBOL if you're familiar with that. If you're not, it doesn't matter. So this isn't super important for an introduction. This is just understand that everything's designed in kind of a hierarchical manner. So this is hello world in COBOL. This is about, this in fact is not the simplest COBOL program you can have. But let's sort of review this. So there's four main divisions. There's an identification division, and that's mostly used to just identify the program, what the program name is, or put some other things in there as well. The data division is where you declare variables and so all your variable declarations go to the data division. The environment division, honestly, we never even used in the COBOL version we had. I think it's used for mainframe things, for JCL type stuff. We never use an environment division. And the procedure division is where your code goes. If you're not using a division, you don't even have to declare that at all. So you can get rid of those, and then this is really like the shortest possible COBOL program. And that seems pretty wordy, right? Anyway, so there's like really just one command here, display. Display is like write lin. So it's going to print the string and it's going to put it automatically put a new line at the end. And, right, so that's, and when you compile it, this is going to be the name of the program. So you could call this Hello World Cobe, and your program is going to be called Hello World. By the way, I tested everything on, there is a version of, there's a COBOL compiler that is GNU COBOL, maybe on Linux, that is able to test these things out. So this seems pretty wordy, right? Compared to like the equivalent in Perl, right? But it's, I mean, compared to that to what you have to do in Java, I mean, it's actually shorter than Java, isn't it?
A lot more readable too.
It is a bit more readable too. Like, what is? Yeah. I think that is true. I cannot argue with that. So we saw display. Let's look at some other commands. Let's do various mathematical things. So, move A to B. So, this, in most other languages, is going to look something like this. So, that's really B equals A. So, you're taking whatever is in memory location A and storing it in memory location B. You see COBOL statements, like this is probably the most common COBOL statement, is the move. Super, like it's used all the time. If you want to add something, there is not, you can't just put the math directly into like inline if you do it in most other languages. You have to say it like this, so there's another way you can do it as well. But typically you say something like this. So you say add A to B giving C. So that is really C equals A plus B. Right? Everything is wordy like that. Oh, and they end in periods too. They don't end in semicolons or nothing, they're periods, with some exceptions, we'll talk about that. There's lots of clauses that are optional. So that the giving thing is optional. So if you just say add A to B, what you're really doing in like a C-ish language is you're saying B plus equal A. So you're taking A and adding it to whatever is, you're taking B, whatever's in B, adding A to that and keeping it in B. So you could, I guess, say add A to B giving B. But add it to whatever is already there, you can feed the giving part off. So you can also put constants in. They don't have to be variables. So you can say add 1 to B, and that would just give you B plus plus. That's why there's this joke that object-oriented COBOL should really be called add 1 to COBOL. Someone got it. So subtraction works the same way. So you can subtract A from B giving C, and that's that, right? And again, you can leave out the optional parts. Right? Multiply kind of works the same way. The syntax for, notice that like everything is like a little bit different, so that it's not always, like the words kind of vary depending on the operation you're doing, so it sounds more like English. So it's add to, subtract from, multiply by, divide into. So that's C equals B over A. If you say divide A into B, that's just like that. You can say divide A into B giving C remainder R, and that's kind of different. That's assigning two different things. So this is like a modular operation, right? That's the remainder and this is the division, but it's going to chop the remainder part of it off. There's also this crazy thing that you can say, instead of the into, if you say divide B by A giving C, you actually end up with kind of the opposite of what you might expect. Divide B by A is different, right? Divide A into B, divide B by A, yeah, so whatever. I mean, you see, I don't know why they had that two different versions of divide, but they do. So you can kind of see that compared to the equivalent in most languages that you might be familiar with, you know, your C's, your Pythons, your C++'s, Pascal even, will look more like this red column and much less like that column. And in fact, COBOL programs tend to be really wordy and kind of stretch across the line, even for kind of similar things. So COBOL's all like this. In fact, there's like over 300 reserved words. There's lots and lots of reserved words because there's optional clauses and there's different ways of doing things. So it's very, very rich in, it's very poor in operators, but it's very rich in reserved words. There's hardly any operators at all. And you can say, I don't think I have a slide for that, but there's also a command called compute, which works more like the way we normally think of as math working. I'm not sure I have any slides for that. So you can kind of see the difference side by side between COBOL syntax and with some syntax from math. I had this slide before. So if you want to have blocks, there's two different ways of doing that. You can either, let's do the one at the bottom first. So let's do the one at the top first. In this case, we have an if and then another if else kind of embedded in there. Don't worry so much about the syntax. Just look at the way that it's indented. This period, so every sentence ends with a period. But the sentence is this outer if statement. If you were to put a period like here, you would end the entire statement, and the next thing would start with the whole sentence, and you would start a new one. This ends the entire thing. No matter how much nesting you have, one period ends the entire thing. This, I think, is considered a feature by some COBOL people, but I think this is, it's very hard to see, for one thing. And you can get confused with copying blocks of code from one place to another. It happens to have a period. You can get screwed that way. You can also have, if you don't want to do this, you can also end, you can block things with if, end if, read, end read, things like that. So you can do it, you can actually do it both different ways. Another reason why you end up with so many reserved words. Also note that COBOL likes to use dashes instead of underscores. It's like this, end dash read, end dash if, invalid dash record. It's much, much more common to use a dash. I'm not sure if the underscore was even in EBCDIC. That might be part of the reason. I'm not positive about that. So another reason why having these periods is a problem, like someone had mentioned this before, that when COBOL was kind of column oriented. So originally COBOL was, if you were using COBOL, you were doing it on punch cards. And the thing about punch cards, they had to have, you had your code on punch cards, but you also had to have sort of meta information about line numbers and things in case you like dropped the stack of cards, you could get it back the way that it was. So when you were writing the code, you had, the code all had to fit between columns 12 and 72. And there were certain things for reserved for like line numbers at the beginning of the lines and for other sort of controlled things. Comment was like a C in character in column 7, I think. And then anything from 73 to column 80, which is how wide punch cards were, those were also reserved for like comments, or we use them to designate like revision information because we didn't have a revision control system.
I can't even imagine what that was like. Holy.
So we had like, two systems, and so we of course, I mean, I started working on this in, like long after the era of punch cards had ended, but still because like that code, that convention was so common that our COBOL compiler had to switch for whether to do it to use those column restrictions or to just have it be completely free for it. The system I generally worked on was the order entry system, and that was freeform. But the order entry system, right, customer service was free form. Order entry system had the column restrictions in it. So going back, so you could, once you compiled it, it didn't matter. But the code itself, it didn't very much matter whether it was looking for it or not. So one point we had a problem where I couldn't, no one could figure out why the code all looked perfectly fine, but it like wasn't working, like it was creating bugs. And it turned out that this, the period that was ending some block, because it had been copied from somewhere else, the period was in column 73, so it was ignored. And so the block, it didn't end the block, it just kept continuing on and on and on. So you kind of get the sense that it's still, so from this, not so much for this, for other one, you get a sense it's sort of a wordy, it's a wordy language, but I would argue that it's wordy in the same way that SQL is wordy. And no one really complains about the wordiness of SQL, but people do complain about how wordy COBOL is. And the other different, they're being used for different things, but it's from the same mindset, really, that SQL is. And if you think that COBOL is wordy, has anyone looked at Objective-C code? What this code does is, this code trims the white space from a line, so from a character. So the input is a string, which has some white space at the, I forget if it's the beginning and the end or just the end. Let's say, I think it has both. There's some white space at the beginning, some white space at the end, and this mess trims the white space off the front, from the beginning and the end. But it doesn't, in fact, handle new lines. If you want new lines, you have to do this, right? You need to change the character set from white space character set to white space new line character set. And this is a little better in Swift than it is in Objective-C, but not so much. So right, they have very long names of methods and very, like, everything kind of gets spelled out. Then the parameters all have to be named as well. I think that's a feature, but it does become pretty unreadable, I think. So another language that I think is kind of wordy in the same way as COBOL is this. Does anyone recognize what this might be from?
Is it batch? No?
Nope.
Is that stuff from the shuttle?
It's that you're close. This is code from the Kerbal Space Program. This is KOS code, the Kerbal Operating System. So this is kind of like batch programming for the Kerbal Space Program. Does anyone know what the Kerbal Space Program is?
How do you spell that?
What? K-E-R-B-E-L?
It's a video game.
K-E-R-B-A-L. It's a video game where you're helping these aliens develop their space program. So they're building little rockets and you help design their rocket systems, propulsion systems, and things like that. And so here I think they're trying to automate like the launch sequence or something like that.
But it's less of a game, more so like a simulation. It's really hyper physics rules and design physics and stuff.
So they actually have inline math, but they also have like block steering up to things, and, right? So it's a little bit. Okay, so we talked a little bit about the syntax. Now let's talk about the data declaration. The data declaration is really at the heart of COBOL. So data declarations are all put into, you remember from that long hierarchy that the data division has so inside of the divisions are sections. You probably don't remember that. But the key section in the data division where you put most of your data declarations is in the working storage section. So here we declare three variables, name, age, and answer. They all start at a one. I'll have examples. If you want to have things that are nested, things like structures, you would go above 0-1. But in this case, everything's at the same level. So I started 1. X means, so while you can say that they're like regular internal format, it's more common to use these pick stands for picture, and you're kind of saying exactly how the data is going to be laid out. So in this case, name is in, pick X means it is an alphanumeric character, and the number means that there's 10 of them. You could also have 10 X's going across if you wanted to do that. I have some examples with nines later on. But if you have enough of them, it's easier to put it into number. Okay. So this is going to be 10. It's a name could be from is going to be up to 10 characters long. Pick 9 means that it's a number. So that means it just means it's a character for between 0 and 9. And there's going to be 3 of them. So this can store anything from 0 to 999. Here the answer is 5, but here we're giving it this optional clause for a value, and here it's going to be initialized to 42. Okay, so this is pretty straightforward, right? So you can also nest the thing. So here, it's typical, these numbers don't really matter, but typically you go 01, then 05, then 010, you kind of go up by 5s. And it doesn't have to be that way. If you could put something, if you went from 5 to 10, you could put an 07 or an 08 in between if you needed to do that. So these are exactly like I was doing before. So here at MM, here we're defining a date that has 3 parts, a month, day, and year. And each of those are 2 characters. And you can either, once you have a hierarchy set up like that, you can move to any level of it. So you can move the entire date string to the top level to my date, or you could just move 22 to DD for the day. And this is in fact exactly the Y2K problem. We have tons of code like this if you see that type of thing. So is this okay, understand this? Pretty simple, right? And of course you can go beyond that, so you can go up to 10. So here the customer has a name and a location, and the name has 2 parts, first name, last name, and the location has address, city, state, zip, all with different things. This is what the record layouts look like. I put this little kind of U-shaped thing to indicate a space, because when you move something in, you always get that exact number of characters, just like certain string formats in SQL. So if you were to move Barack, which is, 6 characters, to first name, which is a pick X 10, it's going to move Barack in there, but you're going to have 4 characters at the end that are just spaces. And the same thing goes with all the rest of these things, too. If it's too big, like the city is 10 characters, Gotham City here is 11 characters, and it just gets chopped off. So everything's fixed with data. Let's go next. All right. So you might ask, so when you have something like this, so like how can you reuse it? Right? This is like you have to put if you have to just put this in your working story section, you're kind of how do you reuse it? How do you have input customer and output customer or something like that, or customer 1, customer 2, maybe you want to compare 2 customer records. So what you do is you take everything but the top level and you move it into some other file, like essentially an include file or a header file. I forget exactly what we called it in QVC. I don't think it was .h, but it doesn't matter. Let's say that it's .h. All I took was what I had on that previous slide and took the 01 level off. So we have that in one file. Then, inside the main program, you define your 01 level and you say copy. And then copy is like a pound include in C. It's going to take what was there and just insert it into your code because the compiler is going to do that as a compiler. So then there would be some other code down here. Right? So now we have a cust 1 and a cust 2. Now you might say, well, how? Like, how do I make sure that it goes into the first name of Cust 1 and not Cust 2? And this is yet another optional clause of. So if you left that off, you would get a compile error because it doesn't know where it's supposed to go. But if you want to make sure that it's in Cust 1, then you have to say of Cust 1. And there's lots of, there's some other things. I don't know if I have slides for them, but you can also, another common thing is if you had a report or a screen that you wanted to fill in, and you might have this very long customer record, but the screen or the report only has a subset of those records. What you can do is, if you have the field names in the report be the same as the field names in your data structure, you can say move corresponding X to Y, and it'll move just the fields that have the same names from one record to another record. So, which is also kind of nice. So, why even bother with all this? Like, why are we care so much about these fixed length records? Well, this was what a 5 megabyte hard drive looked like around the time that COBOL was being written. I mean, storage was extremely expensive, and like there wasn't very much of it. What was there was like super expensive. So they really micromanaged every single byte they were putting in or taking out of their systems. And that's still, I mean, even today, that's still really true on mainframes, that storage is, like, we're used to storage being super cheap on PCs, but really commodity hardware. But they're not using commodity hardware in IBM mainframes, so they still kind of micromanage everything. So it's important to try to get, to try to pack things in as tightly as possible. Also, this is what reports look like. This is, I don't know, I just found this on the internet, but this is very typical of what the reports we were generating at QVC look like. And like everything is in fixed, like this is, everything here is at a fixed format. So there's only so many columns that can fit everything in. And these prices and the strings and everything had to fit in a very strict format. So it kind of made sense, because everything was like that, to have a language that was kind of optimized to deal with these fixed length records, because everything you were dealing with, the storage was fixed length and the reports were fixed length. Things on the screen were fixed length as well. And it's still like super common. I mean, Rich today on the IRC channels was talking about some report format, some data format put out by the US government, like Border Control Service, where if you're bringing fruits or vegetables or plants or anything, pharmaceuticals across the border, it's this crazy long format and it was all fixed length records. So another thing that COBOL is pretty good at, in addition to these fixed length records, is money. Dealing with monetary things. Part of the issue with money is that it comes in, you have to deal with cents. And anything you want to deal with, so that means you're dealing with floating point numbers. And floating point in binary really sucks. And so, I mean, there's all sorts of reasons why that is. I mean, one example that I like is that this is what 1/10 looks like in binary. So all I'm doing here is just doing long division, right? This is 1 and this is 10 in binary. And I just did the long division like you would do, like we learned, I don't know if kids still know this, but I just did the long division and worked it out. You cannot even have a 1/10. Like 0.1 in kind of a close, nice, simple closed format. And like it's all like that. No matter what you do, you're going to end up with rounding errors. And maybe it's not going to be a big issue. But if you're a bank dealing with billion transactions a day, you're going to get screwed with it. So they really wanted to account for every single penny, or tens of pennies, in what they were doing. So how does COBOL deal with this? So I already talked about this a little bit. This is what numbers look like, right? So let's say this is a car odometer. And in fact, it works. This is a good example, because odometer, it works exactly the way like traditional car odometers work. So this would, if you don't initialize it to anything, it's going to start at 0000. And if you add 1 to it, now it's 0000001. and then 2, and then 3, and it'll keep going until you get to 99999, and then if you add 1 to it, again, it wraps around to 0. Okay, so it's never going to try to expand out of that. It doesn't wrap around to like negative 1 or negative 99999. It's, you go from 000 to 99999, and then back to 0. Okay, so what if you wanted to add a tenths of a mile? Like most odometers have tenths of miles too, right? So what you do is you use this V, and the V means like a virtual decimal point. I'm not sure if that's what the V actually stands for, but it's effectively what it is. So now this is going to be treated, it's actually, this is still just going to be six spaces, six positions in storage, but the compiler takes, remember, just knows where the decimal point is supposed to be. So it would just be stored if you had, like, if your number was, I don't know, 1, 2, can I write on this, right?
Yep,
this is
yep,
the whiteboard.
Yep.
Right, it might look like that, but internally this period isn't really even there. The compiler is just sort of just plopping that in the middle and just knows that it's supposed to be there. Do I have an example? I must have an example. So, okay, so the nice thing about that though is that because it's really doing the math as like in decimal and not in binary, that all of the math works out without any kind of round off errors at all, with the exception of the rollover thing that I mentioned. So if our total is supposed to be, so let's say we've already calculated the price and we've calculated like a 6% sales tax on this. If you just want to see what the total is, all you have to do is add these up and you don't have to worry about round off because the tax was already truncated or rounded off, whatever, to 2 decimal points. And when you add, you're also just going to get 2 decimal points. And you don't have to worry about any of the stuff that you have to worry about when you're dealing with this as like an IEEE floating point number instead.
So if you wanted more than 2 digits after the decimal,
you would put
the.
Oh, right, that's right. I should have said that. Right, so this is two different ways. You can either say, you can either put how many digit positions you want, in which case 5 for all of these, or you can just put that many numbers, that many nines or x's or whatever. So I could also say B9 parentheses 2 close parentheses.
I work with financial software, and we have different like fixed width file formats, and the definitions for them for the like. There's a matchup format, it's like ACH, money transcripts with banks. They're actually written out in that format with like the 9 such and such. I didn't realize that was
right, so they took it from COBOL. They certainly took it from COBOL.
Well, it'd still be in COBOL on the other end.
Yeah. So you might say, well, this is, I'd be okay, the math is going to be exact, but it's also going to be a lot slower because you're not using this internal format, you're using like actual, you have these like ASCII or epsilon digits that you're adding. So one way you can kind of get around that is to use binary floating decimal. So what that means is that, you can stick 2 digits into every byte. So what this is doing is, right, so, you know, like, hex digits go from 0 to F, right, they can go from 0 to 15, but you don't necessarily care about the A's through F's, but you do get 0 from 9, and that means you can put 2 0 through 9 digits into a single byte, which is what they're doing. So here we have the number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, as it's being stored instead of in 8 bytes, it's being stored in 4 bytes, because this is 1, and this is 1, and that's 1, and that's 1.
You can't really see that red.
Oh, should I get?
The color.
I really can't get it. better?
A little bit.
I'll just try to make it bigger then. Does that make sense? So, right, so you can put two digits. So now it's only being stored in half of the width. Similarly, if you had pi 3.14159, again, it knows where the decimal point is kind of intrinsically, so it doesn't get stored. And right, so this is being stored in just 3 bytes, and 4985 is in 2 bytes. Let's see, what's about other things before? I think they use A through F to do things like storing negatives and maybe like not a number or something like that. Mainframe CPUs have had internal commands to do arithmetic on BCD since like the 1960s. So it's probably not going to be as fast as like IEEE floating like that, but it's going to be faster than trying to just deal with individual digits. Designate something as being BCD is you say that it's COMP3 for computational 3. I think that's what COMP stands for. Right, and then once you do that, then you can still use them exactly the same way. But you can add them together just like I was doing before. But at some point you're going to want to put the. Let me get rid of these lines. But when you want to print them out, at some point you have to put these decimal points that you've been leaving off back in when you want to print them. So you have to use another, so there's nothing like a printf statement in COBOL. What you have to do is declare another variable with a different pick statement that's going to look like the way you want it to appear when it gets printed out. And that's what's going on here. So this is like that, except that instead of the B, it's a period, right? So that means that it's an explicit period and not this virtual one. And the Z means that it's going to be space delimited instead of zero delimited. So it'll have, when you go to print it out, if it's like 4995, it's not going to be 0004495. It's going to be space, 4495. So then what you do is you do the math. Oh, but the math is still going to be faster, so you wouldn't do the math this way. In fact, I think the COBOL compiler I was using for Linux wouldn't even let you do math on this. This is strictly a presentation thing, but you can't do arithmetic on this. It's just straight. So you add it the way you did before. Once you have this total, you move total to this total form, this formatted version of it, and then you display that, and then you get the one that has a period and doesn't have leading zeros. So now, does that make sense? Okay, so now let's look at some sample code. So let's see how you do a Fibonacci sequence. So we all know what Fibonacci sequences are, right? So the first one is either 0 or 1, and then sometimes you start the sequence at either 1, 1, or you start at 0, 1. And then everything after that is the sum of the previous two values. So it's a very common, like, they're super useful in nature, but they're also like a pretty common introductory programming assignment to do. So, of course, there's like a zillion ways to do this in Perl. This is one way to do it in Perl. I'll go through it, like, you see that it's taking in like the what you want the nth Fibonacci number to be. It's initializing the to 0, 1, and then until you get to the end, it takes the first one to do multiple assignments. It puts the second one into the first one, and the second one becomes the sum of those, and then it returns it. It uses big int because if it gets big enough, it's going to quickly. Fibonacci numbers get big pretty quickly, so big int basically lets you go beyond like whatever you can store in a long like 4 gigabytes thereabouts. You don't have to do that in Python. Python has big ints kind of built into it. If you're doing this in Perl 6, it's even smaller because Perl 6 has these lazy evaluated arrays. So you just sort of set up what you want the array to be. So here you started with 0, 1, and this means that everything else is the sum of the previous two. And it doesn't matter how big it is, because when you go to ask for like the 10th one, it'll do that. If you ask for the 100th one, it'll do all the work to get the 100th one. So do it in Perl 6 in like two lines of code. So then I didn't want to write my the whole Fibonacci thing in COBOL from scratch. I kind of did that, but I thought I'll just go to Rosetta Code, and I'll find their Fibonacci code, and there it is. It's a bit more code than what Perl was. Let's go through it and see what's going on here. So. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So part of this, the reason this is kind of a mess is that you need all the variables have to be there twice. You need some of them, these ones at the top are the, these three are to do the arithmetic. This desired count is like what the nth Fibonacci number you're getting is. And then these are for printing out. It's going to print out, in fact, the first n Fibonacci numbers. So these are the formatted versions of these. So everything kind of repeated twice. So what the code does is it asks you which Fibonacci number you want up to 173. That's why this is 35 or 36 characters, because that's how big it's going to get. That's the 173rd Fibonacci number is 35 or 36 characters. So what do we do here? Right. So desired count is what we want. If it's less than one, that means we're done, and it can just do it. If it's less than two, it just displays what the current Fibonacci number is. We'll show that at the bottom, and it's done. Otherwise, it has to go into a loop to start calculating. So it subtracts 1 from the desired count. It displays what the nth Fibonacci number is. And then this compute Fibonacci, right, so it does that, and then it goes into this loop where it keeps doing it over and over again. This is how you do a loop. This is one of the ways you do loops. So you can give it a block. So this is essentially a go-to. These are labels. This 100 compute Fibonacci is a label. 200 display Fibonacci is another one. I think I'm just scrolling up. So this is sort of labels, the block. So when you say perform this, it's going to perform this until it hits another label. So it's going to go from, if you say perform 100, it's going to do this, like this through this. When you say perform 200, it's going to do this through that. And this part isn't super magic. It's just kind of doing the arithmetic. It moves one to the, you know, has to save the one. It displays something, it does the, this is what the compute statement looks like. So that is interesting. This thing is mostly ugly because it's trying, the way it prints it out, it doesn't have the leading spaces for it, so it takes off the leading spaces in some kind of crazy way using unstring. Unstring is kind of like split in Perl, if you're familiar with that. So anyway, this is a mess, right? And it's kind of a mess for two things. One is that it's trying to print these things out to a commit to the command line, which COBOL programs like weren't really designed to do. It's also trying to remove the leading spaces from it, which again, it wasn't really designed to do that. So, it can do that stuff, but it looks ugly when it's trying to do that. So. Okay, so this is something that COBOL is particularly bad at. So now let's look at something it's really good at, fixed length records. So here's our record from before. And if I want to set up with Bruce Wayne going in this, all I need to do is just a bunch of move statements, and I'm all done. I can move them in here, I can print the customer, I get the full customer name. So if I move Bruce to first name and Wayne to last name, and then I say display customer, it's going to display Bruce Wayne. And similarly with the address, it'll say Wayne Manor, Gotham City, New Jersey, yada, yada, yada. So this is super simple. I don't, most modern languages can't handle this very well at all. So as an example, I tried to do this in equivalent code in C. And again, I couldn't even fit it on one slide. It's about as long as that crazy COBOL program I just showed you, right? So here's the structure. And I have all the sizes about the same. Oh, this filler thing is another thing I left out. The filler was something that's very common in COBOL because you only have so many bytes and it's very hard to add extra bytes to a record that's a fixed length record. You'd have to move the entire file someplace else and recreate it. So what you can do instead is you can have fillers, which you have 10 bytes of filler at the end of your records. So that gives you some slack space in case you suddenly decide that you want to store like a zip plus 4 in addition to the zip in your customer record, say. In this case, I'm adding this filler because I want to be able to print it out as a null terminated string. So it's very hard even to print this thing out. So if you're familiar with C, you know that just because I have these records, C really likes character strings to be null terminated, but these aren't going to be null terminated. I want to have them be not null terminated because I want them to look like that fixed length record that was so easy to do in COBOL. So I wrote this function called fixed move. So this is from and to, and now I have to give it a size. And now I have to be really careful because when I move it, I want to move just the characters that are in it, but I want to pad it out with spaces too, which is another thing that like C isn't going to let you do that by itself. You have to do this all explicitly. And now, like, it's a pain in the butt to do these moves, so you have to put the size up in front of everything. So I made a poundify fixed move that automatically puts the size up there, and now the actual body of the code looks like this, and it's starting to look like, this is what like the Perl compiler code looks like. Because it's all written in like the C preprocessor instead of actual C. And this is really like just, it's still just giving me strings. This isn't giving me numbers. And it's not really checking all the sizes. I wasn't really checking it if it was too big. And you know, I have to put a null in this filler character in order that I can print it out easily, whereas in COBOL I just say display and it just prints it out. So so it's kind of a pain, right? Like it's difficult to do this in C because it wasn't designed to do it, just like it's hard to do the Fibonacci thing in COBOL because it was not really optimized to do that. So it's a little easier in Perl because Perl has these things called pack. This command's called pack and unpack. So you can kind of do it, but like what the hell is this, right? Like A10, A10, A25. I mean, it kind of gives it to you, but anyone use pack and unpack in Perl? I mean, I have, but in some.
I've used pack to handle fixed length.
Exactly this, right? I mean, you can do it. You can do it, but like. Again, this is not really, it's not really checking that it's not going to truncate things if they're too big, I don't think, or it's not, yeah, it's still not as nice as what you get in COBOL out of the box. So I asked this question, this is the final of the talk, right? Like what modern programmers can learn from COBOL, what can modern programmers learn from COBOL? As it's like COBOL's approaching really like its 7th decade in use. So, you know who these two gentlemen are? Paul should know who these people are. Well, you know, this is Alan Turing, and that's Alonzo Church, who I think Turing was his grad student.
doesn't go on his mini posters.
What?
He doesn't go on his mini posters.
No, he really doesn't. Between the two of them, they came up with this idea that's now called Turing completeness theorem, which basically says that so this is an idea from like theoretical computer science that they have this idea of a Turing machine, which is a very simple computer that has really just this simple paper tape and a state machine that sort of drives it. And you can do pretty much any algorithm you can think of can be done on a Turing machine. So therefore, if your programming language can simulate a Turing machine, it can do any of it, it can essentially do any algorithm. So in some sense, all programming languages are more or less the same. But they're really not the same, because some of them are good at some things, some of them are good at other things, but they are at some level really the same. So I think in computer world, we kind of think of these things as like these arguments between Perl and Python and Ruby or COBOL or C or whatever as holy wars. And like, I think that instead we need to think of them not as holy wars, but as like engineering trade-offs. So this is this is James Bond's submarine modus. This by the way. So some lessons I think we can get from COBOL. One is that I talked about engineering trade-offs a lot. This is the Amfa car. And it's not a great car and it's not a great boat, but you know, it kind of is a car and it is a boat, and those people seem to be enjoying themselves on a day out on the water, right? So that's one thing that COBOL is really good at. It's a very simple language. Like, anyone can kind of learn the basics of it in a few days. And you know, it's very easy to read and understand what's going on with it as well. Your boss, who might not even be a great programmer, could be looking over your shoulder, you could be explaining a problem to him or her, and they would be able to understand what the issue is and how you might go about fixing it. It's also, in some sense, kind of a domain-specific language, right? It's a kind of a domain-specific language for dealing with fixed-length directories in a really good way. So it kind of filled this niche of wanting to deal with currency and like strings and customer records and things like that. And it's that niche is still kind of there. It's like, you know, demonstrated by that slide I had at the beginning with the number of new lines of code and all the business transactions that are still going through it even today. Perl programmers like this expression that we pronounce "timtoting," which means there's more than one way to do it. I think that COBOL's motto might be WYSIWYG, because you're never going to run into a situation like, I was a COBOL programmer for the better part of 10 years, and I didn't always love it. But I'll also say that I never spent a lot of time, like I have done in Perl and some other languages, staring at a particular line of code trying to figure out what the hell I or another programmer was trying to do with this. The code was always really straightforward. It might not have been the most elegant code you could possibly imagine, but I think that you do, when you're programming COBOL, tend to think in terms of solving the underlying problem and not the like trying to come up with clever coding tricks, because there are no clever coding tricks you can really do.
There's something with that though. I've always found if you get the data structure right, the rest of the code can write itself.
That's very true.
And if you screw up the data structure, then forget about it. Just go home. And yeah. COBOL forces you to get that data structure, like that's the first thing you write, practically.
Right, data structure, because you have to have that in order to do it.
Right, so you have to have thought that data structure out ahead of time. You have to have written it down, and if you got it right, the rest of it writes itself. And you don't even have to fart around with printfs and formats, shit just lines up.
Right.
And that was something that I actually did enjoy about it.
So I think that COBOL's kind of like the flux of computer languages. People, I don't know if anyone's played Flux. Flux is this great card game where like everything you could possibly do is written down on the cards. So even if you've never played the game before, anyone can sit down at a table where other people are playing Flux and immediately know what's going on because all the rules are like right there. So like you know that the goal is that you have to get these certain things to get time and money. I think it's a clock and money. Right, time and money cards, right? So if you have those in front of you, you've won. But it's kind of changing, and like other people play cards, so that those don't happen. So you always know like how many cards you're supposed to draw because like the rules, all the rules are always laid out right in front of you like that. And I think COBOL is kind of the same way. Like you're never wondering, well, what? How many cards should I draw? Well, I know because I have to draw two. It's right there. It's right there on the table. How many cards I'm supposed to draw? So like I'm not saying that I want to go back to the days when I was programming COBOL. I'm sort of happy as a kind of MATLAB slash C++ slash Java slash JavaScript programmer. But like I do think that there's like those lessons that we can draw from it. And like I do think, like I said, that I think that there are some things that it got right. Probably a lot of things that got wrong as well. So that's COBOL. So any questions?
Quick question vis-a-vis performance. How does similarly cast things in, say, just C perform against like COBOL? Is COBOL faster? Is it slower? Is it? Let's say you're doing math, for example. Do people still use COBOL?
I think for the types, well, I would guess the math would be a little slower. It depends what you're doing for math. If you're doing math using PICs, it's probably slower, right? Because it's not using an internal format. It's not using a type thing where it's only a few bytes to store it. I'm going to guess that most COBOL programs, the computation is not the thing that's slowing it down, it's the I.O. that's slowing it down.
Sure.
The COBOL programs are generally going to be I.O. bound and not CPU bound.
Okay.
Modern program. I mean, for the types of math you're typically doing, which is hardly anything more than adding and multiplying, subtracting, it's just plenty fast to do that. And I think for moving data around, I'm kind of guessing it's a little faster, but I think that kind of the trade-off you're making is even if it's a little slower, you're trading off maybe maintainability, although, I mean, there's other issues, obviously, with COBOL and maintainability.
Sure.
It's not great. It's not a great language of doing subroutines or things like that, right? It's not very good at doing subroutines. But you're trading off, like, not having to worry about data overruns or floating point round off errors and things like that. Anything else?
The data, is that stored like a flat file? Is that how that
Yeah, everything's stored as flat files. Right?
Yeah.
The things I was talking about are all flat files.
Okay.
You can certainly use COBOL to access databases, SQL databases as well. I honestly have never done that, so I can't talk too much about how it works. But I imagine it would be pretty similar. Because COBOL, SQL record layouts are pretty similar to PIC sequence, like similar enough that I would expect it to be pretty straightforward.
Okay. So if the numbers are in PIC format, is it doing like the way you would manually do math instead of doing binary?
Yeah. And those are going to be slower, certainly. So we did you know things that didn't have to be like that, like a loop counter or something like that. If you're loop iterating over, let's say, an order, like I want to put everything that someone's ordered, all the items in a particular order up on a screen. So we're going to have a counter for that. And that counter, I would have a comp, that, there's no need for that to be like a big nine. So anything like that, we're using it totally as an internal thing. I honestly, because I don't have any of my old code lying around, I thought that all we had to say was like, you know, comp 4 was a short and comp 5 was a long, but I wasn't able to get that, I was never able to figure out exactly how to get that working in the COBOL compiler I had, so that's why I don't have any examples for that. But yeah, you would, for things where you didn't care about, where you're never gonna print it out, you can totally do it in an internal format and it should be hopefully just as fast. You know, because it's just doing regular arithmetic on CPU then, so I would have to be super slow to do that. But yeah, it's probably not gonna be quite as fast, but mostly what you're doing is like, the things we're doing were reading from files, writing to files, printing reports, and like that's the part that slows it down. So, writing to screens too, and so, yeah, Stratus is at least, you can drive a whole bunch of terminals for a single process, so if that was waiting for IO, another process would pick up, another thread would pick up and work with it then. So, yeah.
So, your opening comment seemed to propose that the reason there's still so much COBOL around is because if it's broke, don't fix it. But then, kind of the way the whole talk resolved was...
Well, I think I'm trying to say... I'm probably trying to say both. They're both... If it were an absolutely horrible language at doing things like that, it wouldn't have lasted. Because there were other... Fortran is the other language from that era, right? And Fortran is still around, although it's not used nearly as much as it was back in the day, because there's so many other languages that can kind of do similar things in kind of a similar way. But COBOL, there's not really a lot of languages that can deal with fixed length records as well as it can. So I would say it's true. I think it's still really good at what it does. But it's also super entrenched in what it's doing. And I think it's kind of telling that even as all those things I mentioned at the beginning, ATM transactions or cell phone transactions and things like that, sorts of things that came around after what I would think of as the heyday of the mainframe and COBOL. People are still creating new systems to handle those transactions, including COBOL. So, I don't know how those decisions are getting made, really, but they are. Certainly, I think it's clear that those people that Rich was talking about today at the border control people that came up with that crazy record format, they absolutely have COBOL on the back end, because there's no way they would have designed systems like that otherwise. We used to, obviously we didn't use it at the stock exchange, this was back in the 90s, I had no idea whether the format still looked like this, but when we would receive quotes or send out quotes, like someone says that I want to buy IBM at $50 a share, something like that, those sorts of records that would go out from Philadelphia Stock Exchange to the other stock exchanges had a fixed length record format exactly like these. They're sort of nice because the transactions were slow enough that you could put what the hell were those things called? A stiffer on the line, you could actually look at the data going across the line and see exactly the records going through exactly as they were reading, which is kind of nice for debugging. Because the whole setup was complicated, right? It wasn't just the code, it was making sure things were wired in properly. There was a lot of networking stuff that they had to be right to. So that kind of makes sense. So, yeah, it's been both. So,
how many millions of lines did you say were written every year?
There's 5 billion new lines of code every year.
All right, so cut that by 10 or 20 if it was Perl or something else.
Right, I mean, part of, I mean, a lot of that is also that it just takes a lot of lines of code to do anything in COBOL. It's not a terse language. I find them, while I would say this about Objective-C COBOL as well, that while you can certainly look at any particular line, it's very explicit what it's doing. I find that reading through like the entire flow, like I think of programs, I'm so used to programs as being kind of a vertical thing, like this is my algorithm, it's kind of doing this and this and this and this, like a whole bunch of steps, whereas when it starts stretching across the line, having to go to several lines in order to do it just because of the verbosity of it, even if it's very explicit, whatever all that says, I'd rather have it be a little more terse and be shorter and be able to get more of it in than just a single line. But like I write Perl for fun too, so. So I'm not going to be the right person, and I was a math teacher, so. There's pluses and minuses, so there's a plus and minus. Certainly, Swift is a lot personal than not personal. So, Apple realizes that to some extent. Any other questions? We're going to go out and start reading COBOL. And get into the super ugly stuff. Basically, every subroutine really wants to be in its own file. And there's another section of the work of the data called the linkage section, and that's where you declare the subroutine variables. It's actually not unlike MATLAB also likes to have subroutines living in separate files.
What do you think that they're replacing COBOL with? So are they slowly replacing it, or they have no interest in replacing it, say like a bank, for example? I mean, they must have some sort of plan. Is what would be a suitable modern language to be replaced COBOL? Would it just be C, or?
So I think that like part of the issues, like the reason they might want to be getting rid of it is not so much that it's not doing the job, is that it's hard, getting very hard to find COBOL programmers,
right.
Like they're all,
yep.
They're all in their 60s and 70s at this point.
Yep.
Although you can make very good money as a COBOL programmer. I mean,
sure.
It's kind of boring work, but you can make very good money doing it. I honestly don't know. I mean, I think that if all of your data is living on a mainframe, I don't even know really what your options are. I guess there are report generating thread generators and things like that that you can take some of it off of.
Well, it's not that bad. DB2 has, you know, plenty of like ODBC, and I think SQL Server is going in there and saying, listen, you were doing data manipulation in COBOL, we can do it just as well as SQL Server, we just have to build all these clusters where before you may have had it in one box.
Right. Right, but that's not going to be an easy migration either.
No, it's not.
That's going to be an expensive migration in terms of like the code and the hardware and everything. So,
but it can always just be in the back end, and you know, you aren't building any new front ends to it, but it's just sitting there as a repository. So who cares what the front end is?
Maybe
it can be a little more graphical.
At QVC, the warehouse and like all the financial stuff ran on. That was the mainframe part of it. That was one of the mainframe part of it. That was all COBOL on the mainframe. So there was a lot of COBOL there. I don't know if they moved some of it off. We were trying to get some of the stuff off of COBOL from the front end when I left, but that was like in 2000. I don't know where that stands now. Yeah, I'm glad I'm not talking about it.